سلام، در برنامه امروز با یکی از منتقدان توافقنامه احتمالی ایالات متحده آمریکا با طالبان گفتگو میکنیم. تام مالینوفسکی، عضو مجلس نمایندگان ایالات متحده، از وزیر خارجه این کشور خواسته بود که تمامی بخش‌های توافقنامه احتمالی را با طالبان در اختیار کنگره قرار دهد و بخش‌های مبهم این توافقنامه را روشن بسازد. امروز از ایشان بیشتر درباره انتقادهایشان از این توافقنامه احتمالی میپرسیم. کانگرسمن مالینوفسکی، ویلکم تو دی پروگرام.
Thank you. Happy to be here.
Thank you. You sent a letter on 13 August to Secretary Pompeo seeking assurance that the Trump administration makes the full text of the deal it signs with the Taliban available to Congress. Did this happen?
No, it has not happened. But as you know, peace process, or at least ambassador efforts, have slowed down that time. There was a deal which apparently President Trump walked away from. And so we have a chance now, I think, to make the negotiations and a bit more print. It's, of course, up to, in my view, up to the people of Afghanistan to decide how they want to resolve this conflict with the Taliban. But I feel very strongly that we, the United States, should not be negotiating about you without you. This should be transparent, not just to us, but to the Afghan government and to the Afghan people.
So do you support the President Trump's action?
I was happy that he backed away from the deal that apparently Ambassador Khalilzad was negotiating. We do know the broad outlines of that agreement. It required the Taliban to cut its ties, but not necessarily other terrorist groups operating in Afghanistan. It did not place any requirements on the Taliban in Pakistan, where, of course, it is working closely with other terrorist groups. It was not clear how this deal could be enforced, whether some U.S. troops would stay in Afghanistan until it was clear that the Taliban was, in fact, abiding by its commitments. So I didn't think the deal, certainly I understood the Afghan government was not happy with the outlines of this deal, so I'm glad President Trump walked away.
Is there a possibility that the potential negotiations resume and there will be changes in the deal?
I think there would have to be some changes. Ambassador Khalilzad has continued his efforts. I know he's been in Pakistan recently. I want us to continue to work for peace. I'm skeptical that he wants the same thing, but we should always be open to the possibility. But any peace agreement, in my opinion, needs to take into account the interests of the Afghan government and Afghan people, and it needs to be enforceable in terms of the commitments the Taliban makes about ending support for terrorism.
Which the current deal doesn't, in your point of view.
In my opinion, the deal that Ambassador Khalilzad was negotiating, based on the outlines that we understood, was not sufficiently enforceable. And it did not apply to the Taliban's actions and its connections to terrorist groups in Pakistan. Of course, we know that the border between Afghanistan and Pakistan, from the Taliban's point of view, is an artificial one. We either deal with the Taliban movement or not at all.
Do you think Ambassador Khalilzad is after withdrawal, or he wants to make sure that Afghanistan is a peaceful country after the potential deal with the Taliban?
I think that the problem here is that President Trump was just after withdrawal. He had promised to remove from Afghanistan, and I think Ambassador Khalilzad felt that if this was going to happen anyway, he might as well try to get some commitments from the Taliban along the way. Unfortunately, I think that the Taliban saw that as a very advantageous situation for them, that they could, were leaving anyway, that they could make only limited commitments, and that they had all the leverage in that negotiation. It's good that President Trump has now indicated that he's not just after withdrawal at any cost, that this happened under acceptable conditions for American national security, and I would hope also for the security of the Afghan people. If the Trump administration holds to that, then we will have better leverage in these negotiations and hopefully get a better deal.
You also said that you don't want the U.S. military to stay in Afghanistan even one day more than necessary. Under which conditions you think the U.S. should leave Afghanistan?
Well, I think number one, we would need very firm commitments from the that it will break with all terrorist groups, not just Al-Qaeda, but the Haqqani network and others. The deal should apply to Taliban activities everywhere, including across the Pakistan border. I think for me, it needs to be acceptable to the Afghan people. I do not want American troops to leave to see the Taliban continue its quest, total power in Afghanistan, which would lead to more violence, more conflict, more human rights abuses, an end to the progress that Afghan women have for years. And ultimately, under those circumstances, American troops would probably have to go back at some point. All of these interests need to be in some way taken into account in a deal. And then timing is important as well. We need to test it in a step-by-step way, rallying all of our troops and hoping for the best.
So a deal that doesn't secure the rights of women and minorities and also the press freedom will not be acceptable to you?
Not to me. You know, under the Obama administration, we said that any deal with the Taliban must require the Taliban to respect the Afghan constitution, including the rights that it guarantees to Afghan women. I think that should continue to be the United States. That's the right thing to do. And also, I think it's the practical thing to do, because if the Taliban are not willing to make that commitment, well, that tells me that they are not actually willing to share power, that they are continuing their quest to achieve total power in Afghanistan, which should be unacceptable to the United States.
Do you support a government based on power sharing, which includes Taliban also?
Well, I think, again, if this is acceptable to the Afghan people, this should be led by the Afghan people, of course, then yes. If the Taliban want to share power by running in elections and convincing the that they should be trusted with a share of power, then that would have to be acceptable to the United States, I think. But I would not support a deal that simply gives them power that the Afghan people are not willing to give them through the democratic process.
During the 18 years conflict in Afghanistan, many foreign fighters were integrated among the Taliban. What do you think should be done to these fighters in a U.S.-Taliban deal?
Well, it's very important, and I think Ambassador Khalilzad and President Trump agree that the Taliban end its ties to other terrorist organizations, including foreign terrorist organizations. I think that commitment has to be comprehensive. It cannot just name Al-Qaeda and ISIS, because there are other terrorist groups operating on Afghan and Pakistani soil. And of course, it would have to mean no more coming to fight or to take shelter in Afghanistan. And this has to be tested over time. So I wouldn't mind reducing the U.S. troop presence. The plan was to reduce it to 8,600 anyway. But I would not complete pullout until these commitments have been met in a verifiable way.
The U.S. has already reduced the number of its troops in Afghanistan by 2,000. Do you think it will give the Taliban an upper hand in the potential resuming of the negotiations?
Now, our military commanders believe that that the current force levels are sufficient to help the Afghan government continue to defend itself. As you know, the suspension of the peace talks, military operations again have increased in intensity. So I don't think we have lost leverage at all. I think our leverage is a little bit higher right now.
During recent months, U.S. has increased airstrikes in Afghanistan, and it has resulted in civilian casualties also. Do you support the increasing of these airstrikes?
I am concerned about the civilian casualties. I think it's important that if the United States is still fighting alongside the Afghan government, that our military follow the procedures that were put into place under Generals McChrystal and Petraeus. We need to be there to protect the Afghan population, not to further endanger it. Of the peace. If the U.S. military withdraws from Afghanistan, as some, and that doesn't necessarily mean an end to airstrike. I mean that those airstrikes would be conducted from a much further distance. We could have drone strikes launched from the Persian Gulf or from Central Asia, where the drones would have time to linger over their target in Afghanistan, which would mean more civilian casualties. I'm also afraid that if regular U.S. forces are pulled out, forces that partner with Afghan military, there might still be CIA operations and special forces operations, again from a distance, partnering not with the regular Afghan army, but with special intelligence units, with local militias. And again, I think you would see more civilian casualties under operations.
Do you expect that the U.S.-Taliban deal will force the Taliban to publicly denounce the other terrorist organizations allied with them, to denounce these groups and cut ties with them?
I believe it should do that. I think it. Al-Qaeda is not the only terrorist group in Afghanistan. Terrorism is terrorism, and we either end it or we don't. So I think it's important for any deal to require the Taliban, if it wishes to be a legitimate political force in Afghanistan, ties with all terrorism.
During last weeks, the NATO and other foreign officials have insisted that they will not let ISIS to establish their destroyed caliphate in Afghanistan. Do you think that this shows that ISIS is being regrouped in Afghanistan, is trying to make progress in Afghanistan and take territory?
ISIS has been trying to make progress in Afghanistan even before the end of their caliphate in Syria and Iraq. And so it's a risk that we have to take very, very serious. As terrible as the Taliban has been, ISIS is a genocidal organization responsible for the deaths of tens of thousands of innocent people in Iraq and in Syria. We have to do everything in our power, working with the Afghan, for that this does not happen.
Afghan people are worried that there will be a deal between the U.S. and the Taliban, but the insurgency will not end. The ISIS will take the place of Taliban, and it will fight like them or even more violently than them. So they ask, what will be the benefit of a U.S.-Taliban deal for Afghanistan?
If it is a good deal, if it is an enforceable deal, it would enable the Taliban to help us to fight ISIS and to ensure that that a worse, more dangerous, more violent terrorist group does not gain a foothold in the country. So this is one argument for a peace deal. And I agree with that. I just want to make sure that the peace deal is one that the Afghan people and Afghan government support and one that can actually be verified and enforced.
If a deal cannot ensure the Taliban sanctuaries inside Pakistan being destroyed, can we be hopeful that it will bring peace to Afghanistan?
I think a deal has to address the Taliban presence and activities in Pakistan as well. And I think what that means is that they have to end their cooperation with terrorist groups, not just on Afghan soil, but on Pakistani soil, and that the other conditions of the deal have to apply to the Taliban wherever it may be.
Do you think the U.S. has brought enough pressure on Islamabad to address these challenges?
I'm not sure if we have yet, no. I think.
What should be done?
I think we need to make clear to the Pakistani government that we are willing to stay as long as it takes to make this work. One of the fears in Pakistan is that the United States is just going to leave, and so therefore Pakistan needs to take its own steps to protect its interest. And traditionally, we know what that means. That has meant support for the Taliban. So I think the best posture for the United States is to say, we don't want to stay forever. An acceptable deal that enables American troops to come home. But we're not going to come home without an acceptable deal. We are prepared to stay in support as long as it takes. Ironically, the more committed we are to stay, the easier it will be to leave.
Will you introduce any legislation against Pakistan if they don't end their alleged support to the terrorist sanctuaries?
I'm not sure about future legislation, but we are watching this very, very closely in the Congress. We are considering different legislative options to influence the Trump administration's decisions about the peace process and about the troop presence. No member of Congress wants to stay indefinitely under any conditions. Most of us, I think, agree that that the investment that American troops have made with our Afghan partners will not be squandered too easily.
How can we reach to such a deal that ensures the rights of women and minorities and press freedom? How can U.S. sign such a deal with the Taliban?
Well, again, I think we need to stick to the position that was first established by the Obama administration, that any deal has to commit the Taliban to support the Afghan constitution, including especially its provisions on women's rights, press freedom, and human rights more broadly. And at that point, we need to move forward in a step-by-step fashion. Taliban is actually serious about meeting those commitments. In other words, we don't just pull everybody out because we've signed a piece of paper. We want to see how this actually works in practice. So that's the only way I think it can work.
What should be done if these rights are on the paper but not actually practiced by the Taliban?
Well, again, I would not, it has to be a step-by-step process in which every step the United States and the Afghan government takes is tied to steps that the Taliban take, so that we build confidence along the way. And, I would start with small things. I would start with prisoner releases, for example, which I believe Ambassador Khalilzad is focused on right now. That's a small way of building confidence that each side is willing to actually do something to satisfy the other side's demands. And then you can move on from there to something else.
You support the involvement of Afghan government in the peace negotiations, but do you think that the current Afghan government can do that? Can do this? Can it bring peace to Afghanistan? Can it negotiate with the Taliban a deal that will be acceptable to all Afghans?
Well, that's not for the effort. And despite all of the problems that you know far better than I, it is a legitimate government that speaks as well for the Afghan people as any government can. And I think it's important that representatives of the Afghan government and Afghan civil society are fully involved in the peace process. Otherwise, it can't work.
How important is ceasefire for resuming of U.S.-Taliban talks and starting of intra-Afghan negotiations?
I think some form of, perhaps not a nationwide ceasefire, but in key areas of the country, will be very important for building confidence in this process.
Do you see any great objection to the U.S.-Taliban deal among the U.S. politicians, government, and Congress?
I think there are serious questions. Ambassador Khalilzad made one very big mistake. He did not brief members of Congress about the deal. We asked for months that he come and testify to us, that he give us a sense of what his objectives were, and he did not do that, which means that there's not a lot of confidence in members of Congress. We don't. There's not a consensus that America should stay in Afghanistan forever, but there is a consensus in the Congress, Republicans and Democrats, that we should not lose the gains of the last 20 years, that we should not give away what our troops have sacrificed so much with the Afghan to gain. So we are watching this closely, and we will insist that Ambassador Khalilzad be accountable to us.
We'll have.
With that, I think I only have like so.
We have short time. Just two more questions. If Afghanistan can secure a peace deal that ensures that Afghanistan's soil is not used against the U.S., do you think that the U.S. government is determined to withdraw troops from Afghanistan? I mean, it will not have another foreign policy issues like Iran and other countries?
I think most Americans would like from Afghanistan. The question is, what are the conditions and whether there can be a deal that gives us confidence that the gains of the last 20 years will not be lost.
The last question, Congressman, do you see the possibility that the U.S. and Taliban resume their talks And it fails again due to another abrupt and unexpected tweet of Donald Trump. Do we have to expect the repeat of this action?
We are all nervous about the next unexpected tweet from President Trump, not just when it comes to our Afghanistan policy, but when it comes to everything that is important to us in the United States. It's a very strange situation we're living in with this president, but we do have the U.S. Congress providing some stability, and whatever we do in Afghanistan is in the U.S. national security interest, and that it takes into account the interest of the Afghan people.
Another question, not about Afghanistan. Did you support the legislation about the impeachment of President Donald Trump?
I did, yes.
Congressman Malinowski, thank you for your time.
Thank you so much.
Welcome.